Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. I'm available for code reviews and on-site training. This episode, I'm going to revisit a topic that I've hit many times, but with some fairly major updates here that I thought you would be interested in. So be sure you stick around. As always, make sure you check out the video description for important links and ways to support this channel. I have spent probably too much of my life thinking about how to get C++, modern C++ on the Commodore 64. And it all started with this x86 to 6502 reassembler that I wrote now many years ago. And the basic concept was that I would compile to x86 16-bit code using the -m32 to make sure I was only in 32-bit mode, x86, and then I would limit it to 386 processor architecture to try to get a modern GCC down as simple as possible, and then translate that resulting assembly into 6502 assembly, which could then be assembled and executed on the Commodore 64. And this worked surprisingly well enough that I was able in episode 19 to demonstrate some C++ 14 code running on the Commodore 64. This was 6 years ago. This was in 2017. And then that led to my CPPCon talk in 2016 of actually presenting a live demonstration of writing some Commodore 64 code in C++ 17 that made a simple Pong game. And I had great fun here. Now, I know some of you complain if I don't get straight to the point about an episode, but there is a story to be told here. Now, I had episode 293 of this RPG and C++ 20 major updates, and I've had a lot of fun doing these things, although I've never really completed any of these projects. Now, at this point, instead of using x86 32-bit 386 code and attempting to translate that into 6502, which jumped through a lot of hoops, I started doing AVR, which is an 8-bit platform with a fairly good number of registers, and those things could be translated into zero page registers in the 6502 architecture. And then I'm still doing this reassembler where I have to parse the AVR, decode which instructions are being used, and then output 6502 equivalent. Or 6510 for the sake of the Commodore 64, but it's the same from this perspective. And this worked, and I actually had a somewhat playable role-playing game. But there's lots of fragile code here, shall we say. So that brings us to the point of today's episode, which is the LLVM Moth project. Now, I have written off several previous attempts at this because they all seem to have a hard time getting the LLVM backend working for 6502 8-bit processors. They tend to die after a couple of months of effort, but this one has kept going and it has been updated as of last week. And this episode is being recorded on January 16th, 2023, and it is up to date with a modern Clang front end and LLVM back end. And this thing supports C++ 23. It generates efficient, optimized 6502 assembly code natively. And it supports a wide range of targets. So let's dump into this real quick. You can download a binary for this pretty easily, and you can see that it has specific targets for Atari 8-bit computers, Commodore 64, CX16, Mega 65, the NES, the Mega 65, and the Commander 16 being more modern reimaginings of these computers and the NES and other targets, and it can just generate things natively. Now, of course, since I'm a Commodore 64 person, I was playing with that. And let's go ahead and jump into this real quick. I have a extremely simple demo here of just taking a pointer to 53280, which is the border, and creating a volatile pointer to this. Now, I need it to be volatile intentionally because otherwise the compiler might optimize away writes to that particular address because it can see that there's no further reads from it. And I'm just going to go ahead and increment this value 16,000 times. And this is just going to be a quick border flash demo just to prove that this code works. And it has a handy puts statement here. So we can play with this a little bit, but do know that it does have a standard library that works and works fairly well. We can do things like puts on the screen here. And let's go ahead and play with this pretty quickly. Let's just point out that this is, at the moment, the most up-to-date Clang front end, and they are doing a pretty good job of staying up to date with these things. So when I just compiled this, it created for me a test.elf and a test binary. And I can launch x64 with auto start here. And we can see it's going to be a little bit slower because of my video capture software slowing things down with the emulator here. And you see that it did, well, it didn't get the lowercase letters correct because we're using an uppercase font right now. The default font is all uppercase. But it did print hello world and then flashed through the updates of the border color 10,000 times. Neat. And automatically ran this, which is helpful. Let's just see if we can use something like standard string. And no, it doesn't have string. It doesn't have any of the standard containers that I know of, but it does have support for the standalone standard library features. So we might have to build up our own const expert containers or something around this, but that's not a difficulty for this channel. We do that kind of thing all the time. Now, just pay attention to the rate at which it's printing and flashing the border color here. We can actually kind of look and see that it's only able to do this about two times per screen draw. You can kind of see that line moving up the screen here. So after 10,000 times, this is going to end. Let's go ahead and enable some optimizations. Now we can do 03. Or we can do OS, which seems to be the recommended one by the authors of this tool. But let's just go ahead and try O3 first and see how that looks. Okay, so of course, this supports all of the different command line options that Clang would support, OS, OZ, O3. And we can see that OZ actually produced the smallest binary. So let's go ahead and take a quick look at that. Now, if we try to object dump the actual executable created for the Commodore 64, we're going to get this file format not recognized. And we can see that an ELF file was actually created for us. And if we want to, we could actually step through all of this generated 6502 assembly. But really, the point here is that it's got all of the modern tooling that you would expect. And I saw that it does some kind of interesting tricks that I wouldn't have necessarily expected with how it does register allocation. But anyhow, there is, in fact, a modern set of tools that is available and up to date for your favorite 6502 based 8-bit computers from the 80s. And if you have any interest in this at all, I suggest that you do check this out and see if you can come up with some fun use cases here. I would highly recommend using their tools over any of the things that I have created in the past because they seem to be doing less of a hack, more of an actual job here. Well, you know, me, a fun aside into some 80s stuff, and I always find it interesting when there is someone else working in this space as well. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly, and be sure to subscribe.